Hello and welcome to the White House. I'm Cheryl Lazar, the host of The Tastemaker on MSN, joined by the Secretary of Education, Arnie Duncan. Now, for the past week, we've received questions from around the country about a topic on everyone's minds, education. Now, if you didn't get to submit a question, we will be asking those shortly. Don't worry, we are live right now and taking all your questions live. Just go to ask-arnie.msn.com or go to whitehouse.gov. So let's get right into it, shall we?
Sounds good.
All right, so we have some questions from Mike, C.D. Lloyd, Kathmandu 12, these are all users, and many others ask about standardizing education curriculum in our public schools. Some people believe that there should be consistent education standards nationwide. Others believe that the individual state should be allowed to mandate what curricula is taught depending on their particular needs. That's available funding, teacher licensing requirements, district size, percentages of minorities, economically disadvantaged special ed, and gifted students, among others, just to name a few. So, Secretary Duncan, how can we balance the needs of students, no matter where they live or whatever, wherever they move, and the specific needs of individual school districts?
Great question, and let me be very, very clear on it. What we want to have is high standards. Mm-hmm. What we've had is states dumbing down standards, reducing standards due to political pressure, and we've been, in effect, lying to children, lying to families for far too long. Thanks in part to Race Atop, we now have 36 states raising the bar, raising standards, college and career ready standards for every single child. And going forward, for the first time, a child in Mississippi and a child in Massachusetts will be held to the same standard. That's important. So that's the standards. You need much better assessments behind those. And we have two groups of states, 44 states together, working to create the next generation of assessments. But then I think curriculum should absolutely be decided at the local level. We don't need to standardize that. We should figure out what's right in each community, let each community figure that out. And then over time, because we have a common measuring stick, we'll be able to understand which curriculum is helping students learn the material they need. So a high bar, very, very clear on that, but give folks lots of room to be creative and to be autonomous and innovate and help them figure out the best way to help students hit that high bar.
It's definitely a balancing act. So KS Jazz notes that President Obama said in his State of the Union address that, quote, no person should have to go broke to receive an education in the United States of America. So would you please go over the new policies that have been put into place to help pay for higher education?
Yeah, this has been a phenomenal breakthrough. It's one of the things I'm actually proudest of. Mm-hmm. And this past July 1st, the higher education bill, what we did is we simply stopped subsidizing banks and said we would make loans directly to students. Because we stopped subsidizing banks, which we thought was common sense, lots of lobbyists didn't think it was common sense, we had a good little battle and we mm-hmm. won. Because we stopped doing that without going back to taxpayers for another nickel, we put an additional $60 billion into Pell Grants over the next decade. At a time when going to college, as you know, has never been more important, it's never been more expensive, and our country's families haven't been under this kind of financial duress in a long, long time. Mm-hmm. So that was a fundamental breakthrough. In addition to that, we reduced loan repayments at the back end, once mm-hmm. you graduate from college, to 15% of income. And then after 10 years of public service, including teaching, and we're trying to recruit this next generation of 1 million great teachers to come into classrooms, after 10 years of public service, any remaining debt you have will be forgiven, will absolutely be erased. So making Pell Grants much more generous, serve millions more students, reduce loan repayments at the back end. We also worked hard, and we dramatically simplified the financial aid form itself. I always said that historically it's so complicated, you basically needed a PhD to fill out the financial aid form. The problem was you were 17, you didn't have your PhD form yet. You didn't have your PhD yet. Making it much easier for parents and students to understand has removed, the form itself had become a barrier. We've removed that barrier.
All right, JRP wonders if there are plans available that can help out those responsible individuals who have existing student loans to refinance with loans that have more reasonable terms.
And folks should go back, if they have current loans out now, just absolutely work with whoever their loan servicer is and talk through whatever issues they might be having. And we give people latitude and flexibility to have those conversations.
Okay. We have actually a question that just came in live right now, so thank you very much. It is common knowledge that a good breakfast is important for success in school, but most schools that provide breakfast only offer too much sugar, too many carbs, and too much fat. What is being done to provide options that help kids start to be healthy?
Hugely important issue and great question. Yeah. And people may not know that actually not the Department of Education, but the Department of Agriculture does the breakfasts and lunches. And Secretary Vilsack has been just an amazing partner. He's working very, very hard to make both breakfast, lunches, and sometimes dinners much more nutritious. He's asking for an additional $10 billion in the Child Nutrition Act, which is going to be up for reauthorization, to support those places that are willing to do the right thing by children. Our children can't learn, they can't study if they're hungry. We have to feed children who are hungry. We have these dual challenges, often in communities, of children who go hungry, and also children who are obese. And we have to challenge both of those. And again, Secretary Vilsack's providing extraordinary leadership there. And we think it's one of those sort of foundational things that we have to get right. If mm-hmm. children aren't fed, if they're hungry, they can't concentrate. Children can't see the blackboard, they can't concentrate. If they're not safe, if they're scared or afraid, they can't concentrate. There's a series of needs, basic nutritional, social, emotional, physical needs that we need to meet before we can start talking about algebra, trig, and AP biology and going on to college.
Definitely. And Barker is among those who ask about school calendar, something you talk about a lot. Two proposals for education reform include the possibility of extending the school day and having a longer school year. We've also heard you speak about the possibility of encouraging schools to join forces with community organizations to create a better school experience. So what analysis has been done to map out how these ideas could be implemented?
Well, there's no one right way to do it. And again, having local creativity and ingenuity is so important. But I'll just tell you why I think this is critical and why we have to do it for our children. I usually get booed by students when I talk about this. Usually adults cheer. But I think our school day is too short. I think our school week is too short. I think our school year is too short. And if you look in a globally competitive economy, children in India and China today are going to school 25, 30, 35 more days each year than children here. And I know our children are as smart, as competitive, as creative, as intelligent as children anywhere in the world. We have to level the playing field. We have to give them a chance. So this means a couple things. I think schools should be community centers. They should be open 10, 11, 12 hours a day. We have 95,000 schools in the country. They all have classrooms. They all have computer labs. They all have gyms. They have libraries. Some have pools. They don't belong to me. They don't belong to the principal. They don't belong to the union. They belong to the community. And we should open up these great physical resources to the community. So after school, academic enrichment, parents, whatever the community needs, ESL classes, GED classes, family literacy nights, potluck dinners. Mm-hmm. The more families are learning together, the better students are going to do. Over the summer, we've done plenty of studies. I don't need another study about summer reading loss. We have children, particularly disadvantaged children, who thanks to the hard work and passion of teachers, get to a certain point in June, and because no one's working with them over summer, they come back in the fall further behind. It doesn't make any sense at all. So we need to be much more creative in thinking about time, not just lengthening the day, but bringing in nonprofit partners, community partners, thinking about these school buildings not as schools, but as assets to the community. And when we can be much more creative and give our children more time in a variety of creative ways, I promise you they'll do much better academically.
How would we deal with the funding of that, though?
So part of it's money, part of it's creativity. Let me give you an example. When I ran the Chicago Public Schools, we had 150 schools that were what we called community centers. Mm-hmm. We had some that we ran from 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and then from 3 o'clock in the afternoon to 9 o'clock at night, the local Boys and Girls Clubs came in and ran them. And so it's about leveraging other resources. When you have YMCAs, Boys and Girls Clubs, I question why they should be putting money into bricks and mortar. Everyone's struggling financially now. Put all their money into tutoring and mentoring and school support and sports and enrichment activities. Use our buildings. And so there is some additional cost, but a lot of this is being much more creative. And if you can co-locate 5, 6, 7, 8 different great nonprofits and social service organizations in a school building, that's where the children are. The final thing I'll say is that for whether it's two-parent working families or a single mom working, two or three jobs trying to make ends meet, or families looking for work, that 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock, 3 o'clock to 7 o'clock is a time of high anxiety for parents. And knowing that that child is safe and doing something positive and productive with good adults is really important. And this, again, I can't think of a better place for that child to be engaged in positive activities than right there in the school building.
So teachers are often asked to stop using proven teaching techniques in order to implement the latest educational trend or stimulus money spending opportunity. So RV asks, how do we encourage teachers to continue to excel without causing initiative fatigue?
It's a great question. And what we just want is for students to do very, very well academically. We want every child graduating from high school. We want them graduating college and career ready. And we want them to have the skills to pursue their dreams, whatever those are. Where teachers are seeing great success with students, we don't want them changing. We want to reward that. We want to replicate that. We want to learn from that. Teacher creativity, teacher innovation, not just the content knowledge, but the personal passion they bring to the work and really connecting with students, particularly students that are struggling, is hugely important. And the good ideas in education are, frankly, never going to come from me. They're never going to come from Washington. They're always going to come at the local level. Great teachers, great principals, school boards, superintendents, making a difference in students' lives. All of our funding programs are trying to, you know, put resources and reward that phenomenal work at the local level.
Mm-hmm. So many people, including Ms. Rev Mom, that's her username, asks how schools can better deal with the negative impact that bullying both on school grounds and via digital devices are having on the educational experience. We got a ton of those questions, actually. So has the Safe Schools Improvement Act of 2009 been successful, and is it being implemented nationwide?
We're working extraordinarily hard on this, and this is one I worry about a lot. We actually hosted just a couple weeks ago the first national federally led anti-bullying summit. And it's basically where we started, that I just absolutely believe if children are being bullied, if they're scared, if they're worried about getting to and from class or to and from school or worried about recess or worried about what's going on in the lunchroom, they're not going to be successful. And it's not just physical bullying, it's cyberbullying, which is on the rise. And that's something that we're taking extraordinarily seriously. Mm-hmm. And so we're putting significant resources out there. We have a great team that's working to help those districts that want to build safe climates and sharing best practices. We had a phenomenal conference of national leaders from all over the country here working with us. But it's one I worry a lot about. Also, just in the past couple of days, we've seen and heard a couple horrendous situations where, a Rutgers student who's gay was harassed or was videotaped and ended up committing suicide. Heartbreaking, absolutely unacceptable. There's a student who's, I think the student government president, student body president at University of Michigan, who's being harassed actually by an elected official because of his sexual orientation. That makes absolutely no sense to me. So whether it's race or gender or sexual orientation, whatever it might be, we have to have tolerance. We have to treat students with respect, and we're going to do everything we can with resources, with the bully pulpit, and with our Office of Civil Rights to make sure that happens.
Because it affects how they respect education and their environment as well.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So we know that we need to improve the quality of science, technology, engineering, and math education in order to be competitive in the world market. So Silicon Valley Dad asks, are there existing programs in other countries or here in the U.S. which have had success in improving math and science scores while keeping students engaged? If so, can they be implemented in our public school system?
There are many successful programs, but we have a long way to go in this area. And this is, President Obama is providing just extraordinary leadership on this. So a couple different thoughts. First of all, in our FY11 budget, we're asking for an additional $300 million just to support the STEM field. So at a time of sort of flatlining budgets, this is a huge investment in science, technology, engineering, and math. What do we have to do? We have to get that next generation of teachers to come in who actually are content experts and have a passion for what they're doing. The president challenged us just last week to bring in 10,000 new math and science teachers around the country, and we're going to work very hard to do that. We need to do better during school day. We need to do better after school. I'm a big fan of programs like the robotics program, science fair competitions, career days where students get a chance to explore their passions and interests. And then we have the great partnership with a set of about 100 CEOs from around the country called Educate to Innovate, who have come together. Sally Ride, the astronaut, is a huge part of this equation. And so this is an unprecedented public-private partnership. We're going to be working together with the business community to provide opportunities for students, school day, after school, summer, as well as for teachers to continue to do research and then ultimately to bring in this next generation of talent. So if you look at any international measure, we're nowhere near the top, frankly, and we have a long way to go. Most recent numbers are, math for 15-year-olds about 21st in the world, science 24th, 25th in the world, not good enough. And it's not just producing the next generation of engineers and scientists, this is the next generation of entrepreneurs and innovators who are going to create jobs that don't even exist today. And so we have to invest, and the president is absolutely passionate on this, and we're going to work very, very hard to get those numbers so that America is again leading the world, which is where we need to be.
How long will that take to get back up to speed?
I don't know, honestly, how long it will take. We have to see progress, you know, quickly in every single year, benchmark our ability to change those numbers. But when our American teenagers are, you know, 20, 24th, 25th in the world, right now, students in Canada are about a year ahead of us in math at the high school level. Your home country, great for you, and yes. I was just there, but not good enough for us. And we have to deal with these issues openly and honestly. There are a set of countries, Finland, Singapore, Canada's done great, Japan, that we can learn a lot from, but we just have to maintain a laser-like commitment. And the public sector and the private sector coming together, I think, is a huge step in the right direction.
Definitely. So Ilsai teacher, assuming they're from Illinois, asks, once again, highly qualified science, technology, engineering, and math teachers have traditionally been too expensive to be hired by struggling school districts. So how will education reform help poor school districts afford teachers with the necessary skills and experience?
Yeah. So this is one of my controversial ideas not everyone agrees with, but where we've had a shortage of math and science teachers for decades, 25, 30 years. I want to stop talking about the problem. I want to stop admiring it. We need to fix it. It means a couple things. I think where we have a shortage, we should pay those teachers more. So you pick a number, 10 grand, 15 grand, 20 grand, particularly in disadvantaged communities, inner city, urban, and rural, we need to pay those math and science teachers more money to serve the students and the communities who need the most help. We need to think of more creative ways to get, you know, physicists, to get chemists, you know, chemistry whizzes to come in and teach our students, particularly at the high school level. So maybe it's part-time while they're doing something at the university. I met with an eminent scientist recently, won't mention his name, internationally renowned, phenomenal career. At the end of his career, wanted to come back and teach at a high school, wanted to give back. Tried to do it because of, you know, crazy bureaucracy at the local level and certification rules, couldn't do it, wasn't allowed to teach, so he ended up at Princeton University. So he's good enough for Princeton, but he wasn't good enough for the local high school, which is where he really wanted to go. Something's wrong with that picture. There's great talent out there. We got to open our doors, bring them into our schools, and compensate them in a way that will keep them in the communities that need the most help.
Why do you feel like it's been so controversial?
Not everyone agrees that, you know, lots of folks think that we should just pay everybody the same. And that's what sort of happened historically in this country. And where we have areas of critical need, math and science being at the top of the list, special education, some of the foreign languages, I think we should recognize where the shortage areas are and pay better. And I think we should reward excellence in education. We have teachers that are doing an amazing job of making a difference in students' lives. We have to recognize that in lots of different ways and learn from them. And a piece of that should be greater compensation.
All right, we have another question live from the live chat, so thank you. Valadek asks, as a current teacher, I have seen how my state, Arkansas, has been affected by No Child Left Behind. And I understand that the law is mostly for accountability. Is No Child Left Behind working? If not, how can it be improved?
So we want to reauthorize early in the new year, and we want to do it in a bipartisan way. A couple thoughts. Where I always give the previous administration credit with No Child Left Behind is this idea of disaggregating data and looking at the tremendous achievement gap and dealing with that openly and honestly, which this country didn't do historically. So that's been very positive. Having said that, there are a number of things I think, frankly, are broken in No Child Left Behind that we want to fix as we move forward. First of all, the law is very punitive. There are about 50 ways to fail, very few ways to succeed. Secondly, it's very prescriptive, very top-down from Washington. Again, I just fundamentally believe the good ideas aren't going to come from us. They're going to come at the local level. Yeah. I know this is an unintended consequence, but nevertheless, it's happened all over the country, is states, because of No Child Left Behind, dummy down standards, reduce standards, which has been horrible for children, horrible for the long-term health of our economy. And then finally, it led to, and I've heard this all over the country, I've been to 42 states, urban, rural, suburban, it led to a narrowing of the curriculum. So how do we fix all those things going forward? First, we have to reward excellence. Great teachers, great principals, great schools, great districts, great states that are raising the bar for all children and closing achievement gaps. We have to reward success and learn from that. We're going to put a big spotlight there. Secondly, we have to be much more flexible. We want to have a high bar, hold folks accountable for results, but again, let great local educators figure out how to hit that high bar. And I'm much more interested in growth and gain than I am in absolute test scores. How much are you improving each year? What are you doing in graduation rates? What are you doing in attendance rates? What are you doing on college going rates? I want to look at improvement in growth or lack of that, not just the absolute test scores. Third, this idea of high standards. I talked about earlier, 36 states, tremendous leadership at the local level, college and career ready standards. We are breaking through as we speak on that one. And then finally, and maybe most importantly, is the idea of a well-rounded education. Yes, reading and math are hugely important. They're fundamental, they're foundational, but so is science, so is social studies, so is financial literacy, so is environmental literacy, so is PE and art and dance and drama and music. As part of our FY11 budget, we want to put $1 billion, a massive investment behind those places that are committed to giving their children a world-class education, a well-rounded curriculum.
All right, so students often feel that they do not have a voice when it comes to their own education, but we've given them a voice here during the live stream, of course. What advice can you give to students who want to be proactive about their education and help themselves and their schools?
We have to empower students. So we have to listen to their voice. One thing that we're going to do, and we really encourage districts to do and schools to do, is to ask students, what's working, what's not? Do you feel safe in school? Mm-hmm. Do you have an adult you can go to help you if times are tough? And that student voice, whether it's on student government, whether it's a student rep on a local school board, students should be demanding a better education. They should want more and should be challenging us as adults. One thing that I'm going to do personally, and I'll make a little news with you, I haven't talked about this yet, but I had a great student advisory council when I worked in Chicago who came up with phenomenal ideas and actually helped to really drive my agenda. I haven't had that at the national level. One of the things I want to do this school year is set up a student advisory council with students around the country who on a monthly basis, I can't do it in one place, but virtually, meet with them, listen to their thoughts, listen to their concerns, and have them help drive my agenda. It was so helpful for me in Chicago, and I want to replicate that here in Washington.
Looking forward to seeing that happen. Thank you for the breaking news right there. All right, Secretary Duncan and everyone watching right now, that's all for now. Thank you so much for answering all of our questions. To learn more and, of course, watch this Q&A again, please visit whitehouse.gov or ask-arnie.msn.com. And for more information on education reform and revitalization, just go to letsredoredu.com, rethinking, reforming, and rebuilding U.S. education. I'm Cheryl Lazar from the White House. For NMSN, I'll see you soon. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you.
Thanks so much.